Welcome to Everything Rodeo, where we separate champions from the rest of the crowd.
We'll take you down the trail of someone's life, a long haul to a rodeo, and our everyday adventures.
So brace yourself,
because it's fixing to be a wild ride.
We're your hosts,
Mace Renfrey
and Cody Stanley. Welcome to the Crawl Space, Mr. Gizmo McCracken, Episode 7, Everything Rodeo.
Welcome.
Hey, glad to be here.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Oh, man, I'm tickled. You guys got some plumbing problems or something we're going to fix down here in the crawl space? I thought we had maybe a broken pipe or something.
This is actually like covering the plumbing that goes right to my toilet.
Oh,
right.
Yeah. Well, as long as you're here, we're okay, huh? We hear a little rumbling going, I'm out of here.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Well, thanks for joining us today. We just kind of want to get to know you a little bit. You live in our area, and we see you at a lot of rodeos that we film, so we just want to get to know you a little bit.
Well, great.
And just hear your story.
Well, yeah. There you go. We'll see you next week, folks. No, that's great. We have, like you say, we've been here for quite a while when we are home. You know, we've been home for a long time, just about, well, I guess about an hour and 15 minutes north of you, up in the north country. But I like Arkansas. Arkansas is a cool place.
Yeah.
Kind of get aggravated at the people when you travel around the country, you know, and they talk about how the, you know, Arkansas, oh, you're from the South, huh? Yeah. Where everybody makes, you know, you're marrying your cousins or your sister or something like that. Well, I can't help it. I got a lot of hot cousins.
Yeah.
Is that what you tell them?
I'd rather get married to a hot cousin as an ugly out-of-towner, you know? Yeah, besides,
well, then you know all the family.
Yeah. The family's already accepted her.
That's right.
That's good. Yeah. So, anyway, but... No, it's good to be here.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
We're so
glad to have you.
Yeah. So you started, you're not originally in the rodeo industry, are you?
No. Right. My family wasn't in rodeo. And I got into rodeo because a little gal that was the queen of the saddle club. And I figured if I wanted to get involved with that any and be around her, I had to kind of, you know, any relationship, you know, if you want to get in a relationship with somebody, you got to be where they're at.
That's right.
And do what they do and find out what they like. And I always, you know, I broke, my dad was disabled and liked to mess with horses a lot and stuff. Mm-hmm. And the big horses kind of give him a lot of trouble. And he had rheumatoid arthritis real bad. And if you got jerked around a little bit, he was done.
Yeah.
And so we messed around with a lot of smaller, you know, not Shetlands, but the Welch and tight ponies and stuff like that. And dad'd go to the sale and buy a whole pen of little ponies or Welch ponies and stuff. And we'd take them home, turn them out for a while, fatten them up a little bit. And then I'd break them to ride and we'd break them to work and we'd match up a team and we'd sell teams. So that was kind of my cowboy end experience. And got into rodeo with this little gal sitting over here and going to follow her around a little bit.
Is that your queen?
Yeah, it's my queen right there.
That's your queen. All right.
Yeah.
So did you have to go buy you a pair of boots or like what did you do to impress her?
No, I had the boots. Okay. I had to mow a lot of yards to come up with enough money to keep her interested. We didn't come from a rodeo family. I'm the first one to break into that and they all thought I was nuts. Years ago, a fellow named Paul Spencer over at Stella, Missouri, had a rodeo company and Mayberry and Mandels and Dale Hall and Bailey and a bunch of those guys, Charlie Tucker, and a bunch of cats like that that was rodeoing around here. And I got started following a fellow by the name of Norman Bryant. Mm-hmm. And Norman was kind of getting up in his rodeo clown years. And he had a donut or two through his lifetime, so he was getting a little bit out of shape. And I was a young punk wanting to get involved in rodeo, and so I started following him around and doing everything. And long story short, he was trying to quit, and I was trying to start. And when he quit, I took over what he had.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's where we started our rodeo, and where it started to pay anyway. Right. I was getting anywhere from $150, $250 a night then, you know. It was
big time back
knocking her down, buddy. When we worked at a sawmill, I worked at a sawmill when we first got married in 80. And it took my whole paycheck to buy her engagement ring. And I brought home $80.
Yeah. Wow. Is that the same one you're still wearing?
I hope so.
Different one?
You've upgraded?
Nice upgrade.
Yeah.
We're at 100 and a quarter now.
Big time.
Yes, yes. But that's kind of where we started doing that, doing all the rodeos around here, and then working in the wintertime at a factory somewhere, trying to getting back to spring so we could hit the road again, because right. The rodeos around here was just, they was on every corner. You had a little rodeo. Everybody had a rodeo, you know. Yeah. And as most all of them was, you know, three performance even. Mm-hmm. But so that's where we started. I was a bullfighter and did the comedy and did a little bit of everything then. That's kind of what you had to do. You know, get there early and park cars.
Yeah, back then when you was like a bullfighter, a clown act, or a pickup man, you started from like early in the day setting up the pen or raking the boxes or doing whatever you had to do. And nowadays it's kind of like you just show up and do your job.
Right. You know? It's diversified, we like to refer to it as. It's diversified a lot.
For sure.
We have gotten to where, you know, and it's good and bad, I guess. I mean, it's raised a lot bigger and better opportunity for a lot of us. I mean, if a guy wants to fight bulls and that's all he wants to do, well, he can do that. And back then, you couldn't do that. That's a freestyle bullfight. That was unheard of, pretty much. And we always fought a bull at the end of the rodeo, and that was about it. And my bullfighting abilities was, okay, buddy, you got one shot. When your hiney hits the ground, I'm going to run between you and him, and I'm gone. Get your hat and be out of there by then, because if I have to make a second trip, it may not be that pretty. And but, you know, I can save you, you know, and that's about it. And I like that part of it. I like turning bulls back. Back then, you turn bulls back, you know. And I remember, you know, David Bailey, he was so intimidating, you know, to me, you know. And I'd always walk up and say, well, what do you need on this one, Mr. Bailey? And he'd say, I'll just let him jump out here about two, grab his nose and turn him to the left or whatever, you know, and show me some snot. And I remember when he said, I just want to go there. I don't want to touch him. And, but you know, that was what we did a lot. You know, we turned him back and then tried to save a guy when he got off, and then we was out of there. And for what you was getting paid, you know, that was really, he was overworked.
So you started fighting the bulls in like 1977?
Yeah. Long in there somewhere when I was 15, I think is when that was, and which, you know, me and her started a lot long before that, but she was in the rodeo, her dad was the president of the saddle club and stuff like that, and of course, you know, we wasn't big saddle club folks at that time, so that's where I started going to the rodeo to hang out, you know, where she was at.
Was that there in Wheaton, or where was that at?
Yeah, that was the Wheaton Saddle Club.
Okay.
And then, you know, I mean, we had rodeos there, Purdy and Washburn and Miller and Hurley and, you know, all them big towns.
Every little town around there had us a rodeo arena.
Right. And it used to be a great big deal, you know. That's where people went, you know, for their...
socialize.
Yeah. And... it was a big reunion for a lot of folks. And fun times back when it was a lot simpler. You know, there wasn't 19 different places to be today. And it worked out all right, but then kind of went on to getting into moving up the ladder a little bit as we got onto bigger rodeos and our acts and stuff was kind of what, you know, I think I was kind of always had a good act, but
So like one of your most famous acts is the ambulance. So you kind of told me that you built that in like the FFA or the VOAG. So was that when you were still in high school? Or?
Yeah, that was, I built that when we was in high school when I was 15, and I built it and the camera act and the shrinking machine and dynamite, you know, all bunch of
little stuff. So I don't want to age you, but how long has it been since you built that first ambulance?
I don't know if they heard that chicken clucking over there in the corner, but he's like, you know, he ain't got no idea how long it's been. I started when I was 15. Can we leave it there?
Yeah.
No, that'd be 40. This is our 47th year.
Wow.
So I mean, that act has like stood the test of time. You know, that one's been one of my favorites to see you guys perform and,
It's been good.
You see the ambulance, and then you know the Gizmos there.
Well, you know, I didn't give birth to the ambulance act, and there's a lot of different ambulance acts out there, but I am pretty thankful that ours is kind of the ambulance act, I guess. Yeah. You know, I mean, there are a lot of people's known from things, but I hope that when we get done with whatever we're doing here, that people will look at back at our deal and, you know, I sold a character, mm-hmm. you know, I wanted to be a lot of different things, a lot of different people. And a lot of guys, you know, make it on a act, you know, they got a fire breathing dog or a monkey riding a dog or trick ride and all that stuff's great. But I wasn't smart enough to just put that all into one deal. You know? I wanted to have a lot of variety and things like that. And Branson helped us a lot with that. But the ambulance that I built in Voag, I bought an Opel Cadet station wagon.
Okay.
Four-cylinder. And it didn't have but two of them that actually worked, I think.
So it was a two-cylinder.
Yeah, it basically, it was a two-cylinder with some extras.
Yeah, it just, them are extra parts.
You know, you got to have extras. You know, it didn't have electric windows, so it had an extra cylinder. But that thing was a piece of junk. I mean, I remember a friend of mine, you know, I cut it in half. I didn't know anything about what we was doing. And so I buy this station wagon. It's got a hatchback, you know, deal on it. Well, that's an ambulance. I'm in Venice. That's just exactly what I need. So we drag it because it wouldn't run. We drug it up to Wheaton, to the Voag building, and put it in the shop and started cutting it up. Well, because you had to shorten the wheelbase. And I found a guy that my drive shaft, and it was about, I think it was 5.5 inches long.
Oh, my goodness.
It was just two U-joints, basically.
With a little bit of metal in between.
Yeah, just enough to, well, anyway. And so we get this thing, and we start cutting on it, and we realize that a Opel Cadet station wagon, to save you all from, you know, looking it up. I know there's people out there right now trying to say, well, I wonder what that looks like. And they're a unibody. There's no frame.
Okay.
And that's very difficult when you're trying to shorten the frame
on one in half when there ain't no frame to cut.
So when we cut this dude in half, we literally broke it in two. And so then to try to put this back together with scrap metal, because I didn't have two nickels to rub together, you know, I was $80 for my wedding ring, you know.
Right.
And we lived in a trailer house we gave $4,500 for, you know, and you know, you're never going to have another poor day. Yeah. But so everything that we did in that old car was built out of scrap material that I found in the shop. And so the skid plate in the back of it was probably 200 pieces of metal welded together.
Wow.
Because the school was paying for the welding rods.
Yeah,
and he'd give me all the scrap that I wanted. So I get a big plate. If I got a plate that was, you know, 14, 16 inches round.
He's doing really good.
That's a big one there. And so anyway, we built that skid plate on there. Well, it wouldn't rear up. We shortened the wheelbase, but it still wouldn't rear up. So I'm needing more weight. And a friend of mine there at Wheaton, we all rode around town every night, and he said, well, I know what you need. I know what you need, a railroad high, you need, or iron.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah.
And I said, well, that'd be a great idea. Where do you get one of them? And he said, I think I know where there's one at. So we went over to a little town a little south of Wheaton. We always told the kids when they lied about anything, you know where you're going for lying.
Sligman.
Yeah, we're taking you to Exeter. Oh. We didn't have enough gas to get to Sligman.
See, that was mine with Sligman.
Exeter is where you went. You know, we just send you to Exeter. So anyway, we went over to Exeter because you go across the railroad tracks. Yeah. My friend had seen a railroad, piece of railroad iron laying over there. So we went over there, and we was going to kipe that night. Went over there in his pickup with me and him. We had to come back to town and get two or three more guys.
Mm. That was so heavy.
It was about 8 or 9 feet long, and I'm telling you, dude, you ain't got enough hot dogs in you to get that dude lifted.
I thought I seen an old newspaper clipping, like, from a long time ago that, you know, a piece of the railroad track went missing next to So I think we solved the case.
We didn't, you know, little disclaimer, we actually didn't cut it out of the track.
Oh, okay.
It was laying by the track.
Oh. Wait, Exeter has a newspaper?
Yeah, they did. They used to.
I had to tell you who come there, you know. But we put that big old heavy deal on the back of that thing, and then we started up both of them cylinders, and it wouldn't hardly pull itself out of its tracks. But that's where it started.
Yeah.
And then we did that for a while, and then I rebuilt it. What it's on now is a golf cart.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so it works out pretty good. But I've built probably, I think your original question, if you added all this other junk out, you know, when and the first one, how many? Probably 6 or 7 times I've rebuilt the one that I've got now.
Yeah.
Sometimes we change it a little bit, you know, the body style. But it depends on what I got in the scrap pile.
Yeah. So you were clowning before or after you were married?
Clowning, I started before.
Okay.
Yeah. I started when I was 15, got married at 18.
Okay.
She was 16. And
wow. What did your parents think about that?
Well.
Oh, not happy?
Her dad was a mad, mad man.
So did her mom sign off on it? Or?
She did.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
Her mama must have wanted to get rid of her. But daddy didn't think much of the whole deal, which who would? You know, I raised two girls. If you come over there wanting to take one of my 16-year-old kids away, I'd probably have shot you.
Yeah.
And if he wouldn't have been a good godly man, he probably would have shot me too. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we lost him here a few years back. And the cool thing about that is me and Lawrence, her dad, Lawrence Ridenour, we got to be, I mean, I love the man so much. He was my dad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I'd lost my dad quite a while before Lawrence passed away. And so it was kind of neat to, if he needed something done or stuff, his attitude about me changed.
Yeah.
But
that's good.
It was a weird deal. I wouldn't recommend every 16-year-old out there to go get married.
Right.
But,
right. So then after you were married, you'd mentioned something about Branson.
Yeah.
So for those of you who don't know, Branson is a big Showtown, I don't know how you'd explain it. It's a big tourist attraction. So they have Silver Dollar City and all the different shows.
Yeah, Branson is a family-oriented, it's a family place.
Some people call
it Vegas.
Some people call it the family Vegas.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's just great back in those days. We worked a little music show where we had a gospel group, and we was the house band at this little Nashville West over at Purdy years ago. And they'd have different people, little Jimmy Dickens, Buck Trent, and Buck Owens, Merle, Vince, and guys like that would come through there every once in a while. And this lady named Jeannie D came through, and we got to be good buddies with her. And then when a friend of hers put together a music show in Branson, his name was Buddy Green, and he was needing a comedian. And Jeannie was his female vocalist, and she said, "I know a guy." And so in 80... It was 1980, we started on the Branson Opry House as comedian and sang. She ran the lights a little bit and stuff like that. And then we got started noticing if you wasn't family in those music shows in Branson, if you wasn't married into it, or your great-great-grandpa didn't own the place, you might have a short lifespan. And so we looked around into other things. The first year we got involved in an old-time photo shop. And then we bought an ice cream parlor, and then we put in another photo shop. And so we had the three businesses there till the early 90s. And we checked out of there when we was just so busy. I mean, all three of those businesses was open from 9 in the morning until midnight.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And the time you grabbed a little something to eat after it was, you shut down at midnight and did the paperwork, it's time to get up and go again. We did that for about 210 days was the season of Branson then.
Yeah, right.
And our kids was just, you know, go over there and lay down underneath the clothes or get over there in the ice cream parlor office. And they were growing up, and we didn't really know them. And we had an opportunity to sell out. So we sold out, moved back to Wheaton and went back to Rodeo and more. And we did the weekly Rodeo in Branson and a little bit there too.
So there was a weekly Rodeo in Branson?
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yeah, I never even knew that.
Yeah, there was two, actually. There was one before us. And oh, gee, the nice way to say that is, you know, a lot of the music shows in Branson are on the council, and they'd give the rodeo people a lot of trouble, and so they basically tried to run you out of town.
Yeah.
And they did. Mm-hmm. There was the one at Mutton Hollow, which was, Clayman's, I think, was involved with that one a lot, and then Gary Ball put on the one in that we worked.
Mm-hmm.
And it was fun. It was a fun time. You work about 300 people a night for 6 nights in a row and with no cowboys, basically. You just had the guys that worked there and a handful of people. And you'll find out what's in your biscuits when you're working some, you know, them small crowds like that. But so much neat stuff come out of that. The Branson deal, the stage show, And what you'd learn if you went to Branson now is if you come out and sing a song and go back out and then you come back out, you change. You change your clothes. Right. If it's a jacket or ladies, you know, change their dresses, come out with something. There's always something different about you. It's part of the entertainment package.
Yes, sir.
And so when we went back to rodeo on full time, I got into that. You know, I thought, that's what I want to do. I want to sell a character and not a particular act. And so we, you know, I change clothes a lot. I do a lot of different characters throughout the rodeo and kind of keep the kids looking for you. And then hopefully my comedy is a little bit more for the older folks.
Yeah.
I hate to use the word adult comedy because everybody thinks, oh, he does that. No, I don't do that. But you know what I mean? I mean, I want grandma and grandpa and mom and dad, everybody, it's another one of them popcorn jokes. You know, I want my comedy to be a little bit for everybody, but them kids are looking for you. They're watching, you know, they listen to you, but they watch you more than anything. One of the coolest deals, we was at Utah, wasn't it? When the where?
Logan, Utah.
Yeah, Logan, Utah. And the committee man comes over and brings his grandson. And he said, well, there he is. And we're sitting there at the bus, you know, and I didn't have my clown and stuff. I was just street clothes. And this kid looked at me like that ain't him. And he said, I had to bring him over here because he wanted to meet all the clowns.
Yeah.
And he said, so I was trying to explain to him that you were the doctor,
all of them.
You were the guy at the toilet stool, you was the guy riding the ostrich, you was the Willie Nelson, and you was Elvis, and you was the, and that was so cool that kid from watching the rodeo thought there was four or five of us, you know, and so that's one of my neat compliments, I guess, that we've gotten is that they, so I try to keep them wondering what we're going to do next.
So how many characters do you have?
Oh,
just depends on the night, throw an outfit together or something.
Yeah, it does. It depends on the shows. You know, some rodeos you get to do a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
Right. And some of them is geared for not a whole lot of time. And now with the Cowboy Channel coming into things, you know, they want you, you're kind of like a monkey on a chain. You know, we need 90 seconds and then get out of the way. And that's cool. That's what they need, you know. But I like doing, you know, smearing everything together, you know, when things kind of, if they have a hiccup or something, well, I want to be the water.
Yeah.
Be the guy that helps you get that over that. And I don't do a whole lot of joke stuff. It's more comments and one-liners and, you know, and stuff like that. That's kind of.
So what is your favorite one-liner or dad joke?
Oh, dear. I don't know that I've got a favorite.
You probably got a 55-gallon barrel full of them, but
Raleigh.
Oh, I don't know. We have a lot of fun with different stuff. You know, I met a guy uptown last night that we got to visiting. He's a nice fellow and everything, but we realized that his dad and my dad is brother and sister. And, evidently, his dad was transparent. But we can say that, right? Transparent?
Yes, transparent.
You figured out where we're going with that.
Yeah. Yeah, so going back to kind of Branson and stuff, that's kind of where you got your name, Gizmo, right?
Yeah, yeah. That was because I was just plain old Dale at that point, you know, and we started that down there and we was rehearsing for the show. And he says, you know, everybody in Branson, you know, you got Droopy Drawers, you got Herklimer and High Pockets and Zeke and Uncle George and all them kind of guys. We got to have a name for you, you know. Mm-hmm. And so we talked about some of the stuff we was doing and all my stuff is little inventions and gadgets and gizmos and stuff that goes sour on me from a lot of my stuff I got off of like the Wile E. Coyote, you know.
Yeah.
Everything goes south for that guy. And I thought, well, that's a good clown act.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of where we started with that. So Buddy Green, producer and owner of the show, he said, let's just call you Gizmo, the Ozark's greatest inventor. And I thought, well, by golly, that's what we'll be.
Yeah.
And we went back to rodeo on, and we kept the name, and it's worked out pretty good. I'm just kind of like Liberace and Reba.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One name wonder.
Yep.
Yeah, I actually, so I've known you for years because you live here local and stuff. But I text Miranda, your daughter, and I was like, actually, like, right before you got here, and I was like, hey, what's your dad's real name? Because, you know, everybody, you know, I should probably know your name.
She'll get in trouble for telling you. You know, a lot of people, you know.
Yeah.
So is your last name actually McCracken?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. My dad's name was Phil.
Okay.
Phil. Okay.
Phil McCracken.
Phil McCracken. Phil McCracken. Yeah, that was a slow starter, wasn't it?
Gosh.
That one out there, it just laid there.
I didn't want to be rude, you know.
It's kind of like going fishing. You know, you just throw it out there and see if anybody bites. Yeah, Dad would love that joke.
Yeah. Kind of talking about your dad, you know, you lost your dad and your brother within a few months of each other.
5 months.
You know, how did your faith and in God keep you through that?
That was all that kept me through that. Me and my brother was so close because, like I say, Dad was disabled, and me and Spud, we played catch, we built fence, we took care of everything, and he was a dad and my friend, brother, and we was in La Crosse, Wisconsin. At a bull riding, and the girls had stayed home with Mom and Dad at that time. The guide went with us up there to help us, and everybody was scared to death that when I called home that nobody wanted to tell me, you know, until I got home.
Yeah.
And so it was one of those deals where we didn't know until we pulled up, we turned down the road and there was cars everywhere, you know, and I, you know, with Dad being in bad health, you know, of course I immediately thought, cause I just talked to Spud, you know, he had, my brother's name was Carl, but they called him Spud, and which that would have made me a tater tot or something, wouldn't it? But, I never dreamed that it was him. He'd went in to have that, heart, rotor-rooter, I call it, you know, where they knock out some blockage and stuff. And I'd talked to him quite a bit that week, and he was going home. Everything was fine. Long story short, a piece of that stuff broke loose.
And
shut him down, and we lost him at 42. And I about went with him, and it was a pretty rough deal. But I don't understand. I mean, even if you're expecting it, you know. Because I went through that, you know, like, oh, my, you know, God, why didn't you let me, you know, why wasn't I here? You know, how come I couldn't have been here? And then 5 months later, my dad passed away, and we was there with him. And it's like, why'd you let me see that? You know, I mean, you're never satisfied.
Yeah.
And so it was... But if it wasn't, I don't see how people can go through any of that kind of stuff without God. I mean, you know, knowing that, I lost these years with my brother and my dad, and now Mom's gone and her folks is gone. You know, I mean, we all go through that.
Yeah.
But when they know the Lord, we don't really lose them. You know, we got their address. We know where they went. And they ain't even missed us yet.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I think it's one of those deals where that... I know it's just kind of an old cliche, you know, what everybody says, you know, when you hear it so much at rodeos when they honor, you know, someone that's passed away from the local, from the town or something, you know, the empty saddles and stuff like that. And almost everybody will say something like, you know, well, you know, he's old Frank's got the best seat in the house tonight, you know. And it's like, well, that's to me, and the way I understand the word and what I feel like God showed me through that is, Tom, he ain't watching the rodeo.
He ain't worried about it.
No, he ain't even got half the tour done yet. You know, and you think, well, I don't know about that. You know, well, you can think what you want to, but you know, read your Bible. It talks about there's no tears in heaven.
Yeah,
and I think that if there was any way, you know, maybe God lets them see something, a peek of something once in a while, but. That deal about no tears in heaven, I think on our best day, they would be heartbroken to see how we're living.
Yeah, for sure.
Knowing the way we need to be living right. For the man that did what he did for us. And so we need to do better.
Yeah. So we talked about Branson and then kind of how your faith is tied into what you do. But so you joined the PRCA in 92?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that came a little bit out of Branson even, you know, when... I did rodeo schools with Lyle Sankey and Marty Barnes, met them through that, and they kept pushing me towards, you know, get your PRCA card, you know. Well, yeah. We was working you know, ever more, we had more work than we could do where we was at. So why did I need a PR, that other card?
Yeah.
That PRCA card.
Different than a green card.
Yeah. Yeah. They did sort of these cards. And, so anyway, we got me one of them. And boy, they, it was, I wish I'd have done it earlier.
Yeah.
And still yet, it was quite a little battle to get where we were going, but things started moving then. And, mm-hmm. Traveling a lot more, but it's good.
So bigger shows started to come as you got your card and moved on down the road?
Yeah, we was fortunate to get circuit finals, Great Lakes Circuit Finals, and Prairie Circuit Finals, Badlands Circuit Finals, and just kept getting a lot of good stuff happening. Today, we have worked 19, we've worked 10 circuits. There's 12 circuits in the PRCA. We worked 10 different circuits, a total of 19 times.
Wow.
And then just this last summer, they selected us, or last fall, they selected us to do the NFR Open.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we're going to the NFR Open in July in Colorado Springs. And July is going to be a busy time for me. We got 28 performances in July.
Wow.
And so we went from, you know, just barely getting by to God's blessed us so much in our business. And it ain't all been rosy and fun, but I wouldn't have it any other way. I think it's been a great ride so far.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So like, you got your PRCA card in 92, mm-hmm. and then in 2000 there was an accident. What happened with that?
Well, we were in Raleigh, Benson, North Carolina, just south of Raleigh, at a rodeo, and I do a golf act where I had a sawed-off shotgun with a 12-gauge sawed-off shotgun with a shell. And the way I make my shells, Norman Bryant taught me this back when I first started, and if I would make my shells like most guys make them, with a little blank deal and the little stuffing in it, wadding, I probably wouldn't have a hand today. But anyway, the way I make my shells is I cut them off, fill them full of black powder, put a little piece of paper in the end of it, just cut a little round piece, set it down in there, and I put my fingernail polish around that, and it holds that all together. Mm-hmm. But it makes a fragile shell.
Yeah.
If you pop that fingernail polish when it dries, it'll dry. Right. All your stuff falls out, and you get out there to do your deal. You pull your trigger, it goes, and you holler bang, and your deal's over. And so with that, I had always put my shotgun in my golf bag with the barrel sticking up. So when I went in the arena, it wouldn't jar that loose and all my black powder would fall out. So it was always loaded. And so we come to the part of the act. She's out there, my wife's standing out there holding the flag, and I'm fixing to make that wonderful shot. And I reach down in that bag and pull that gun up out of that bag with my hand over the barrel and the hammer. You know, it's when you just pull the hammer and pull the trigger. Yeah. And the hammer hung and something in the barrel, and it blew a hole in my hand, and I couldn't feel my hand. And it is a long story, but I come home with my mom. She flew a friend of mine, Tom Pendergraf. He'd never been on a plane before in his life, and he's about as big as the three of us.
Yeah.
And a stout guy, just a big, strong man. But they said they didn't know if he was going to get him on a plane or not, but they was going to fly him out there to drive the rig back home.
Yeah.
And because we was in the hospital in Raleigh, and I basically just caught a big ball of fire.
Yeah.
And it was just burning my hand. And if I had a wadding, it went plumb through it.
Right.
But anyway, so.
Did you stop the act when that happened?
Yeah, it's pretty much over.
Yeah.
Oh,
imagine.
There's so much. We'll have it's a whole episode talking about this act. But it. That happened, and I'm wired, you know, and so I you know, blows my hand out of there, and I look in my hand, and I see these white stripes, which I thought was bone, and it's my
tendons.
And my hand, it blew off my artery back here, so my hands are just spewing blood out. And she's standing about, you know, 25, 30 feet down there, and I close my hand, and I said, I need an ambulance, and I need an ambulance now, and I start walking towards the gate. And she says, I just looked at him there for a second thinking, why did he do that? You know, I mean, it didn't dawn on her a minute.
Yeah.
And Jerome Davis was sitting in a golf cart at the gate. And he had a cooler full of water there. And when I got to the gate, they stuck my hand in that cooler mm-hmm. and put my hand out, yeah. basically. And then a whole bunch of other stuff started then. And after the morphine, I don't remember a whole lot. But right. the cool part about the deal that I was told later on, the announcer, he says, you said, I need an ambulance, and I need an ambulance now. And I just started saying, Jesus, restore my hand. And I'm a little ball bag. I cry every time the laundry comes home. I'm just glad to see it coming home. But I just kept, claiming, Jesus, restore my hand. Jesus, restore my hand.
Power in the name.
Yeah. He said, oh, man, just say that name. You don't even have to tell him why. Mm-hmm. Just speak the name of Jesus. And he says, I reached over there to turn you off, and I couldn't. He said, how do you turn a guy off that's praying? And he says, so I just let you go. And then they, shut me off later, I guess, when they took it off of me. And then there's a little girl there that, it was a little Sierra that was there that was become, she was my buddy through the weekend. This was the last performance. And me and her got to be buddies, and we letters back and forth, and just praying for me. And her class sent me a whole envelope full of stuff, it was a pretty cool deal. And then we went to the IFR, probably 10 years ago. Yeah. And I seen these people. We was walking through little booths and stuff. Mm-hmm. And they was these people standing there. And just, every time I looked at them, they was looking at me. Mm-hmm. Who are these people? Go over there and shake them down or something, And pretty soon this guy walks over there and he says, the daddy. Mm-hmm. And he says, you Gizmo McCracken? And I said, yes, sir. And he says, I got somebody you need to meet. And here was that 17, 18-year-old girl.
Wow.
And I hadn't seen her since I did that, but she was so much strength for me through that. I was in the hospital and for a little over 3 weeks. I had my hand sewed to my stomach for 3.5 weeks. And, you get to know yourself pretty well when you're sitting there with your hand sewed to your stomach. You're pretty well, he's got your attention.
Yeah.
And she sat there at the hospital with me, slept in an old couch deal there. All that time, I had 11 surgeries in 7 days, totally knocked out, just trying to clean it up and just trying to save my hand. They tried to take my finger and my thumb off when we was in North Carolina, and she said, you ain't taking nothing off till I get him home. And God restored it all. I can feel everything.
Wow.
And it's been an amazing trip through that. But the first time that she left me, well, she's never left me, but first time she left me alone.
Yeah.
Clarify that. Somebody's saying, see, I knowed he was weird. we had a convenience store at home, and they get me back home, and I'm sitting there in my recliner, and she's got everything, from a, pecan pie to a sandwich, and here's your drinks, and here's everything. And she's, I'm going to go to the store for a minute, and she's going to leave me at the house by myself, which is 2 blocks from our store.
Mm-hmm.
So I was on a desert. And so I'm sitting there in the chair, and I was doing some Bible reading and praying. And because, the doctor told her that what the feeling with me not being able to feel my hand is, it's a lot like when somebody gets amputated, has to take something off because you don't feel it and you think it is gone. And so I'm sitting there thinking, what am I going to do? I can't get this to work. And am I done? Lord, what I appreciate what you've done for me, but am I done? I know there was only one burning bush in the Bible, but I need one of them neon signs or something. I need something to tell me where we're going from here. And she wasn't gone very long at all, maybe 30 minutes, when the phone rang. And this guy says, yeah, this Gizmo. I said, yeah. He said, this is Tom Hershing from Cheyenne, Wyoming. And I thought, yeah, right. I don't know who Tom Hershing is, but I know who Cheyenne is.
Yeah.
Cheyenne had never talked to us before. Never. And they walk around us at the convention not intentionally, I don't think, but we just never talked to them. They never talked to us, never showed any interest in us.
Mm-hmm.
And then out of the blue, Cheyenne calls me. Yeah, all right. So I figure that she's told somebody up at the store, he's sitting down there by himself, you got to go check on him, and maybe somebody didn't have enough time to check on me, so they just called me up and said, we'll jerk him around a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, he said, I'm, you know, Tom Hershing from Cheyenne. I'm sure you've heard about our rodeo. And I said, yeah, I've heard about your little rodeo out there. You know? Yeah. And I just kind of talked back to this guy like he's my buddy. And pretty soon, you know.
Not as is a business.
No.
They're not a business call.
No, this is not a business call on First Nation. And pretty soon I get to thinking, I think this guy's for real.
And maybe I should straighten up a little bit.
Yeah. So long story short, to go back to the beginning of that deal, I asked God for a, you know, I need a burning, I need an absolute. Am I supposed to quit rodeoing, stay here with the store, get more involved with our community? You know, what, you know, I mean, I'm laying it out there to him. And minutes, I get a phone call from Cheyenne. And we worked it 2 years in a row. And I don't know if you're in the rodeo business or not, but that is a burning bush.
Yeah, it is.
That don't happen. Mm-mm. And that was what set me back up to, you know, I ain't done here yet.
Yeah.
And then things really started, you know, NFR comedy act stuff and things like that started happening. And it's goes to that old deal about, you know, seek ye first. Mm-hmm. And then he'll give you the desires of your heart. And it takes a long time for some of us knuckleheads to figure that out. But, boy, you can save yourself a lot of heartache if you just do what he tells you to do.
That's right. Yeah, for sure.
But it's been good.
Yeah, I think the best advice I've ever been given was God can do more with your life than you can ever think about doing with it yourself.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and he blesses our obedience. Mm-hmm. You know, people think, you know, well, you know, just, you know, we've taken that, you know, whosoever believeth in me, you know, shall be saved deal. You know, yeah, that's true. But you got to be saved. Mm-hmm. You can't just believe. You know, the devil, you know, he believes better than me and you do. He knows mm-hmm. more about it than we do.
Heck, he lived right there with God.
Right. You know, I seen a deal on Facebook, and I reshared it here the other day. It was so powerful. And it said something about, like, the demons recognize Jesus. The man with 1,000 demons, with thousands of demons, recognized Jesus, but the men with thousands of scriptures did not.
Yeah.
That's powerful.
You know, you need to, you know, just say that again.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it's so powerful that the religious, you know, religion ain't going to get you. Mm-mm. Ain't going to get you up there. And you ain't going to get on the bus. And it's a relationship. Just like we talked about at the beginning, you know, I wanted her. So I had to find out what she wanted. I had to find out the things she liked. I had to be what she needed me to be. Mm-hmm. And that's what we got to do with
God. What we got to do in our walk with the Lord is we got to ask him what he wants us to be.
It's a relationship. It's not a knowledge thing. You know, you can know the Bible inside and out. But it's a relationship, and and I'm thankful I got it.
Was that your rough spot? Your kind of your come to Jesus?
Yeah, we had a convenience store through all of that, and I've always wanted to have an event center, you know, something where, you know, when I get done doing this stupid stuff, running up and down the road, that we've made a lot of connections from music people to, I mean, we've been blessed to be to run with Vince Gill, Sammy Kershaw, and Ricky Skaggs, and some of those guys. For you younger people, you'll have to look them up.
Oh, I know all them guys.
that was country music.
Oh, yeah.
And to get to know those people and stuff, and Ricochet, and, you know, all this different. Anyway, and then the motorsport business, we worked the Outlaw Nationals a lot with them and stuff. And so we was kind of involved in a lot of different deals. So what we wanted to do is my dream for my retirement. Since there's such a wonderful retirement plan in rodeo, you know, here you go, you get the hat. And so anyway, that was my plan. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm going to build me a fairgrounds type facility, and we'll have enough contacts around the country that I can stay right here, and we can have people come to us, and it'll be great. Well, long story, that kind of started falling together, and I was pushing it together a lot. But we got this thing all put together, and we started having things. And every time we had something, we would lose thousands. And, you know, I was never a wealthy man, but I was never really hurting for a whole lot neither. I mean, God had blessed us through Branson and our rodeos, and we'd always made good. Mm-hmm. And we didn't have time to spend any of it. So, you know, it was working out pretty good. And then we got Fort Worth there during that time and come home with that $30,000+ check. And it was, you know, that's what I thought I wanted to do. And the only thing that we did there that worked was the first thing when we got the property and we wanted to do an event there, and we'd come up with, I remember you guys probably heard talk about it, Springdale, Arkansas, where they had the all night gospel singings for a weekend. You know, they'd have the Blackwood Brothers and the singing Leadbetters and everybody was there. I think Elvis would have been there, I think, but they was tied up somewhere else. But they had so much going on there, I wanted to do something like that. So we got involved with a fellow that did crusade-type deals, and so we wound up doing a deal we called Big God Over the Ozarks. And then we just called it Big God. And we did that, and, man, that was amazing. We'd have 2,300 people a night, you know, at this deal. People were being saved and delivered, and the churches around there was all involved in it, and it went for the week, and we had, you know, Sunday school teachers and deacons and preachers' wives and preachers, you know, had all kinds of people getting saved, and then a lot of things spawned out of that, you know, different youth groups and stuff up around home come out of Big God, and a lot of people were saved through that time. And it was just, so every time we lost money at an event, I thought, well, that's just the devil trying to shut us down, and he ain't going to do it. Mm-hmm. And we had our home and our business and everything at that time. And so when we run out of my pocket, we started hawking everything that we owned. And it's just like, you're not going to shut me down. And so we wound up, I used to say we lost everything we had, but we lost all of our stuff. Mm-hmm. And that was really a tough time to sit there and watch people at your auction buy stuff that everything you thought you ever wanted.
You know? You worked your whole life to get.
Right. You know, and that was a tough pill to swallow. And I remember a little gal that was in, I think she was in Janice's class in school, a couple years younger than me. And, you know, everybody wanted to console you, of course, you know, and she gave me a hug there at the auction and kind of whispered in my ear something that I'll never forget. And I wanted to choke her 100 times because that come back to me so many times after through that experience. But she hugged me and whispered in my ear, and she says, you be careful how you handle this. There's a lot of people watching you.
Yeah, because once, you know, especially a small community like we're in, you know, I'm technically in your community where I live. So, you know, in the small community where we're in, if you have faith and they know that you have faith, they're going to watch every move you make. And then especially something like that traumatic happens to your life, you know, how many people are going to prod the mule or prod,
I won't even say the Christians. I'll say the religious people are the first ones to eat their young. I mean, if you get a chance to throw a rock at somebody, you know, I told you old Frank over there wasn't saved. Look at him. He went right back into it. Instead of going over and helping and supporting Frank and helping him fight
lifting
through that.
Lifting him up,
You know, they just I knew that one. And but that really, that came back to me through so many situations through that losing our business, our home, and what I thought of. All I ever wanted. And when you're living in your daughter's backyard in a motorhome, God's got your attention. And then's when things really, we kind of skipped over that a while ago, but that's really when things started seeking him and the desires of your heart started coming around.
That's when all the big shows started calling, really?
This is our, was it just over 10 years? Anniversary of that all happening.
Yeah.
And God has put us back in a better place than we've ever been, financially, spiritually. And I just, And another thing that was said to me through that time, and a fellow that came and preached at our big God deal, he was telling me that, you know, he'd went through a bankruptcy deal that where he just couldn't help it, and things had went south, and mm-hmm. He said, you know, a fellow told me, he said, you know, you may have lost all your stuff, but you didn't lose your ability to get it.
Yeah.
So get back out there.
Go back to work.
And get it back.
Get to work.
Yeah.
And that was those two things that was given to me through that time, I don't think it was just
And I don't think that what you did there has went to waste, because there's still a church in that building, mm-hmm. you know?
That's another story.
God's still working through that place that you built.
Oh, wow. The little group of people, let's back up a little bit and we'll wind up where you're already at. When I put this thing together, before we ever stuck a fork in the ground out there, I was going to places trying to get events to come. Mm-hmm. And Berry County didn't have a fairgrounds, and so we become the Berry County Fairgrounds, basically. When I would go present that to them, I'd tell, like you guys, I'd say, you know, this is what we do, and we don't allow no alcohol. We don't sell no alcohol, anything to do with any of that stuff. We don't allow it on the place. We don't promote it. That's just, you know, I said, we're a family entertainment facility. And I said, now, I didn't build a church, mm-hmm. but we don't do these things. And I'd say that everywhere. I didn't build a church.
It's funny how God comes back and says.
And there was a little church in Rocky Comfort, which is almost as big as Wheaton.
Yeah.
And it's just, there's a little church, a handful of people over there. There's just an awesome group of people, but they're small, mm-hmm. small church, maybe a dozen or so people that really make things happen in that church. And they have had a food bank at that time, and they had old trailers and buildings and storage buildings and coolers and freezers and stuff. It looked like a salvage yard around there, but they were doing such a great work mm-hmm. in that little church that was basically falling down on them. And they was at the event center every time we did something. That 8 or 10 of them people would be there, and they would pick up trash. They'd park cars. They'd run a gate. They helped us however they could. And we was going to church there in Wheaton and all of our community there and everything. But I look back at that, and there was a little man that got saved at our big God deal, that little Billy, I call him. He'd always tell me, he says, Gizmo, he says, you built a boat here. He says, one of these days it'll float. And I got to thinking, you know, you don't know how fast you're sinking, Billy. Mm-hmm. And I mean, we was at a place, you know, we had a big home there, a two-story house that we'd built from Branson, and there in Wheaton that we built from our Ranson days. And we'd come home, and she'd go upstairs in the office and try to spread out a couple of hundred, you know, hundreds of dollars to try to pay thousands of dollars worth of bills. And I'd pace the floor trying to find a nickel. You know, I mean, what can we do to do this? And through our illustrious business of rodeo, had a few incidences where you have pain pills. And I've never did any drugs in my life, but I would take them pain pills to go to sleep. And then when she got to happen to whoop me to wake me up, you know, it was kind of, you know, I'd seen Elvis 2 or 3 times, you know, and he's looking pretty good, really. But, you know, I mean, we was in that kind of a place to where we was just in a bad way. And I really think that handful of people, Billy and that group of people that come out there from that little church, that I think they're the only ones in that area that really knew how bad things were. Mm-hmm. And they didn't know, but they knew. You know, their spirit was telling them that we were in trouble, mm-hmm. And then for them to wind up with it now, and they feed over 400 and some families.
They do an awesome ministry.
It's amazing what that handful of people will do, mm-hmm. And they're amazing groups of people, and there's a lot of folks that. You just better not throw no rocks at that group of people around me. Mm-hmm. They're way ahead of some of them thousands of scriptures and didn't see Jesus walk by.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And these folks, whether you agree with them or like them or not, they do an amazing work. And they sure was a big help to us. And to see them, they came to us one day and says, can you help us get this place? And I said, I don't know what I can do, but, and they did. They got it, and I'm so tickled. And I'm glad I built a church.
Yeah, that's awesome. That, you know, from, you said you didn't build the church how many times? And
mm-hmm. Yeah, it, we sing, we do gospel music and stuff, and I wish we could do more. I really feel drawn to that more than rodeo anymore. But being able to share those stories like that, and it's, I don't know, it's been good.
So Nace had this kind of crazy experience trying to get here. We went to Tulsa last night to watch the ACRA finals.
We was going to go to and got busy. And
so then, was I.
Yeah, he was supposed to be there too. Then we was going to pick him up from the airport and go to the ACRA finals. And turns out I had to go pick him up at X&A today.
Yeah, it was
like
a horrible
30
horrible
minutes before
experience.
You, like when you said you was on our way.
I was getting in the truck.
Yeah.
Coming back to the house.
Okay.
It was horrible. Have you ever flown United?
No, I don't.
Keep it that way.
Yeah. I'm a ground guy, you know. I you know, the Bible says, lo, I be with you.
You know, so, maybe we ought to just drive everywhere.
We should just drive everywhere. I think that's a sign.
If I want to get some coffee or if I want to get out and stretch.
Yeah.
So, you know, have you had any bad experiences traveling over the years?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
we have lots of, I remember back when we first started, we had an old flatbed Ford cab pickup, one seat, bench seat.
Bench seat.
Yeah, it was a bench seat.
Oh, yeah.
You had a little console with your 8-tracks down there in the floor. Yeah. But we had our two girls with us, Cassie and Mandy was with us, and she's sitting over there, you know, we're all brand new at this kid thing, you know, and I've got a 40-foot trailer that I bought from Tom Ward. An old rodeo clown, Tom Ward, and his buck and Ford. And I bought his old clowning trailer, and it was about 40 foot long. It was a homemade built trailer, and we had it piled full of junk. Had two dim lights on the back, no insurance, had a tag off of a pickup bed trailer that I had over there. And we hooked this dude up, and we going to Minnesota. We had us some IRA rodeos for Joe Simon, and we were gone. And so we headed off down the road there, and we're going through construction, which, you know, you can't go anywhere without construction. Oh, yeah. I'm glad that we're building back.
Yeah.
It's not better, but we're building back. And so we're working on, I'm going down through there with this old truck that was going like this. And every time we got fuel in that truck, we changed to oil. You know, it'd take 4 or 5 quarts of oil every time you put gas in it. You know, you knew you was about out of gas when you heard the truck knocking. So we're buzzing along there, you know, and I'm looking out the mirror, and, you know, just half of it, because I broke it on something down through there. And I'm looking at this mirror, and these pylons are just going. And I got one of the girls, I think it was Mandy, standing here between us. Uh-huh. She's the older one, you know, and she'll appreciate that. She's a lot older, a couple years, I think. And so she's standing up here between us, singing, Father Abraham had many. You know, she's dancing in the seat, you know, because you had to have them, you know, secured in your vehicle. We never had no car seat. We barely had a truck seat. And then Janice is sitting over there with Cassie, unveiled, changing one of those
them
nuclear
diapers.
Bombs, and we got the windows down so I can see out.
That way your tears that's coming down from the stench.
Between the movie scene.
Between the tears and the fog on the window, you know.
One of them deals, you know, you don't have a windshield wiper, so you take the the window cleaner from the gas station.
Yeah.
And then when you're.
Oh, the squeegee.
Or if you just tie a pillow.
Yeah.
You just take some string and tie a pillow together, and then she pulls it, and I let it, and we pull it back and forth.
Yeah.
It's cool. You improvise.
Yeah.
So we're.
Oh, yeah, put socks on your windshield wipers.
Yeah, Eddie Hatfield. Don't let me forget that one. So we're going down through there, and the barrels and pylons are flipping out from that old trailer, and she's changing this dirty diaper, and this one here is in Sunday school class, and she looks over at me, and she says, "Aren't we having fun?" Yeah, baby, we got the world by the tail now, you know. But, yeah, that was kind of the fun part.
Did you ever figure out why the pylons were?
I think I was hitting them. Not real sure, but there's a lot of orange stuff on the side of that white trailer when we got where we was going. But then we did, we were selected to do the Dodge National Circuit Finals in Pocatello, Idaho. And Doug Mathis, great announcer, friend of mine, him and Bob's doing Fort Worth right now. And he does a comedy rodeo style show with me in Vegas. And so he didn't have nothing that week. And he said, "I'll go out there with you." I said, "Okay." So we get in the bus and the trailer and we're heading down. And we get out there. Well, Eddie Hatfield and a friend of his had flew out there with him. Eddie was fighting bulls and he was just going to ride back with us. His plane, they delayed his plane a day already. Mm-hmm. And said, "Well, we're leaving. And so you can ride with us if you want to." So he gets in with us, and his friend, "I'll just fly home." He's kind of like you. "I'll be home in a couple hours." Well, so we leave Pocatello in the bus, and it's snowing, beat the band. And we get over around Cheyenne or something, and it looks like, you know, winter wonderland. I mean, it's been rough. And so in that bus, Janice had made a big old pot of chicken and dumplings. Mm-hmm. And so we're eating chicken and dumplings and rolling down through this snow, and the windshield wipers on them buses are so much windshield, there's not enough defrost to keep it from freezing up. So every once in a while, we'd have to stop, and Doug was sitting in the passenger seat there, and he'd jump out and bang the windshield wipers against that glass, knock the ice off of them. We'd be good for another 30 minutes. And so they was all eating chicken and dumplings, and we was having a big time going down the road, and I'm up here just, you know, and anyway, Eddie switches seats with Doug, and Doug's eating, and Eddie's sitting up there, and he said, "You know, man," and he retired at Pocatello that year. He said, "Man, if I knew I could travel like this, you know, I may not have retired, you know," and he's eating it up. And I said, "Man, we're going to have to pull over here and knock these windshield wipers off again, Doug." And Eddie said, "I'll get it. Go ahead, Doug. I'll get it." So we pull off the side of the road there a little bit. Eddie, he jumps out, and he's standing out there smacking them windshield wipers and knocking the ice off of them, cars on the interstate. And so I think, I'll just put me a little funny on old Eddie. And I hit the air horns that's on top of the bus up there. Well, unbeknownst to me, I hadn't checked this out, but it appears that if you're going down the road in a snowstorm and your air horns are up here on top,
they get full of snow.
They be taking in some snow. And so I laid on the horn, and not only did the sound scare him, but I blasted the snow all over him. He thought he'd been run over. And he come back in with, well, I would say that he lost his Jesus for just a minute there. And but that was a funny thing. He says, "Okay, I'm never doing that again." And I said, "Well, I never thought about the snow, but yeah, we've had some fun times like stuff like that." But and that's the neat part about it is, you know, a lot of times, you know, now we don't get back in the beginning. You worked with the same bunch of people all the time. You went, you know, kind of around to the same contractors and the same people, and now you may work. I may work with Bob once or twice, and you know, Scott Grover and Doug Mathis, and you know, you get different announcers and different bullfighters every week pretty much. And we got a lot of stuff with Circle I with Minion Survey this year, and so hopefully we'll get a little bit of that traveling gypsy band deal back together some. But
yeah,
I miss that part of it, you know. You used to get to see everybody every week, and now, you know, when we get to the NFR in Vegas, you know, there's everybody there, and whether you worked with them that year or not, it's just, you just pick up where you left off, and it's a family, like, it's just a cool deal, you know. And the neat part about what with the Cowboy Channel has got to do for us is showing a lot of people that you know, who would have ever thought that the Cowboys and the rodeo folks would be the moral fiber of this country.
Yeah.
And the way we respect our flag and respect our God and
our
country.
Troops.
and our troops, mm-hmm. our veterans, and how we do things like that. I mean, mm-hmm. I'll go there again, but I mean, here in the last 2 or 3 years, we've had football players and sports people like that, you know, that disrespecting our country and our God. And it's been, you know, it's been crazy how so many people just kind of rolled over mm-hmm. to that, you know. And then here the other day, a fella gets hurt, and he's in, they call for prayer, and some of them old boys that maybe did or did not, you know, was involved with this other stuff, but everybody went to their knees, it appeared. And, you know, I heard a guy say the other day that, you know, this, God finishes this deal. No matter how far off track everybody gets, God's mm-hmm. going to finish this deal. And we was all going down the toilet with the way they were doing that. And then here one night, something happens to a fella. They said, I'm not a football watching guy, but they said that this guy was, they resuscitated him for 10 minutes on the field and put him in the ambulance, still resuscitating him. Mm-hmm. I just play a doctor on the weekend, but to me, that means he's gone. Mm-hmm. They're working on him, and God brought him back to life, raised him from the dead, kind of deal, because of the prayer of people, and some of them that wouldn't pray, mm-hmm. in front of millions of people. And
I was surprised. I kind of seen it on Facebook, and then we got home, so I don't usually watch football, but I turned it on just because I seen it, and I was surprised at how long that they actually left it on air.
Yeah, you know? Then the guy that days later mm-hmm. On ESPN, which is one of the most liberal outfits that we got mm-hmm. on the news deal, besides a couple of them other goobers, but the anchor, the guy on there, you know, he just says, I don't know what they're, you know, how they're going to take this, but I'm going to pray. Mm-hmm. And he didn't say a prayer. That man prayed.
Yeah.
I seen I wasn't live. I seen the replay of that deal. Mm-hmm. And so you could tell that wasn't, he wasn't learning, you know, his relationship was there before this happened. Right. And, so I think that's, you know, God's going to finish this deal. He's going to be the one that, read the back of the book. We win.
Yeah, I mean, I think right there's a good place to say, you know, if you don't have a relationship with the Lord, if you don't have a relationship with Jesus and stuff, you know, going back to the verse you said at the beginning is, you know, you have to ask him into your heart.
Right.
If you don't do that and don't want to live for him, then you don't have eternal life.
And it's not just a I believe kind of thing. You know, salvation brings change. Mm-hmm. You know, and if you say you've been saved and you're still doing the same things you was before you were saved, more than likely, you might want to rethink that. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, salvation brings change. It's a repentance. Repentance means you're going this way and you turn around and go the other way.
Yeah.
And if that hadn't happened, if you don't have that change of desires in your life, you know, you really need to check that. Mm-hmm. Because, man, there's another old thing in there that nobody ever wants to hear is, depart from me, I never knew you. Mm-hmm. And the deal there is, I never knew you. It's not that I knew you and you took a little trip, you know, you did those things and, you know, I lost you. You know, he didn't lose you. He never knew you. Mm-hmm. is what that word says right there. And, so it's exciting to see people finally reaching out for something, and there being people there to show them,
yeah,
and to help them to say this is a real deal. This ain't a fairy tale, and you got to be one of his.
Yeah. So you have two daughters.
Yep.
And you have four grandkids.
Yep.
I know two of your grandkids pretty well, and one of your daughters.
Mm-hmm.
Just from rodeoing and stuff, but, you know, kind of tell me what they mean to you.
Oh, everything. I mean, our kids is, you know, besides that little one sitting over there, you know, she's kind of had a lot to do with the kids coming here. Yeah. I tried to order them, you know, this catalog, back order, but she bought them right on up. But the kids, so blessed that we was able to rodeo and holler kids everywhere we went. We had some great experiences from Cassie leading a, you know, breaking a big white rabbit to lead. You gotta try that one, boys. Cool. If you can break a rabbit to lead, you got something going on. But the rabbit just got tired of her pulling on his head and then kicking him in the rear end. You know, I mean, that's how you get him to go. You know, you pull a little bit, he don't move, you just drop kick him about 15 feet out there, and then he'll, next time he feels a little tug on his head, he'll come right along. But she did stuff like that, and Mandy, you know, they trick rode. They went and learned how to trick ride, and Mark Allen out in Vegas taught them whip act and had all this going. That's kind of another story, but we got all them polished up and ready to join the PRCA. They wouldn't sell us a card because they was too young, and so that kind of broke an egg in them, and then they both of them found a couple hairy-legged boys, and I thank God for them, too. We had good men for my girls, and I got great families, and we homeschooled them. You know, they went to school back like before my brother passed away. They was they went through the grade school part, and then they got up there where they had to, you had to be in school so many days, and we was missing too many days, and so we started homeschooling. You know, and it's like, well, that's, you know, well, you're homeschooled, huh? How's that working out for you? And well, one of them's an anesthesiologist, and the other one is the runs an oil company. Cassie runs an oil company and does all the internal accounting and stuff. So somehow she figured it out. Yeah. And Mandy, I just say she's an anesthesiologist because I can't say what she is. A nurse assessionist. Well, I know she don't run the company, but she, you know, anybody that takes care of a lot of the finances, they're running their company. And so she does very well down there. And she's got two girls with Brimley and Rayleigh. Rayleigh was my 50th birthday present. And I've been told that that'll be the last one. They won't be doing that again. And and they barrel race and rope, and they're very in the Oklahoma, the heart of Oklahoma Youth Rodeo Association is what they do a lot with over there. And Cassie's real involved in that, and it's they have church services at all their association rodeos and stuff, and so they do great with that. And I remember when we first took them out of homeschool or out of public school into homeschool. And, you know, you think, well, the kids is going to miss all their friends and stuff and all that kind of thing. And we was out at, right after that, we wound up being at the Grand Canyon, you know, because we tried to show our kids stuff everywhere we went. And so right after they told them that we got out of public school, we're standing at the Grand Canyon, and I was kids there, and Janice, and I says, well, that sure is pretty, ain't it? And Mandy, I think it was, says, well, Daddy, you know what the cool part about this is? And I says, no, what is it, honey? And she says, well, all the other kids back home is reading about it, and I'm standing in it.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
And getting to do stuff like that with the kids, with Niagara Falls and Badlands, we want everything. And they're still involved in rodeo and bringing their kids up in it. And like we just talked about, I think it's the morals, and rodeo ain't what it used to be. Yeah. It's athletes and men and women, that families, and there's so much money involved in it now that I wished I was just now getting started.
Yeah.
But, well, you've got to see it evolve, which has been really cool.
Oh, yeah, the evolving part. Yeah.
Now you just got to write a book.
Yeah. No kidding.
Yeah. We've had a lot of people talk about that. But I don't know that anybody want to read it. Hey, probably ain't nobody listening to this now until they found out who was on. But
nobody's listening now, but they will.
Well, there you go. See, I was right again.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's been awful good to us. We've had a great run, and I ain't planning on slowing up.
Yeah.
So you guys get out to the NFR when you?
Yeah, we've been the last 3 years.
Oh, great. Yeah. You're going to have to get out and see our show.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, we're hoping to hoping this year we can actually set a booth up and stuff. The past couple of years we've been able to visit and stuff, but we haven't actually, I don't know. It's been cool to like get to know people out there and stuff, but yeah, this year we're hoping to actually set up. So
that'd be cool.
So who's your friend you have?
It's out here. It's Virginia.
Virginia.
Yeah. She works out at the rodeo with us and takes us everywhere. Me and Doug kind of.
She's real lively.
Yeah, yeah. She just lays around pretty much. She's just an old cat.
is she a stuffed cat?
Don't tell her that.
Sorry, Virginia.
Yeah, she don't realize that you can just stick your hand right up through her belly and make everything move. But she just lays around, you know.
So who owns Virginia? Which character?
Well, she's kind of self-propelled. She's we use her on the show in Vegas. She just kind of, we did some comedy stuff with her out there, and now everybody's like, you guys said, hey, bring your cat. Like, well, I mean, bring the other guys.
She's famous.
Yeah. Well, yeah, she's.
Really, we just wanted to talk to Virginia. Yeah. You're just an added bonus.
Thanks for bringing her. All right, Virginia.
I want to hear what she's going to tell you.
Well, we thank you very much for coming down to the Crawl Space and joining us.
Thanks for having me. I'm just glad when you said you meet me in the crawl place that you didn't have a frozen pipe or something. You know,
hey,
I
we
put
need
my coveralls in the truck. I was going
to
have to climb under.
Bring your pipe wrench.
Got me some pipe dope here.
Yeah, thank you for sharing your inspirational story, and hopefully it helps one of our listeners. But yeah, the way we close out all of our podcasts is we ask our listener, what is the first song that comes to your mind?
First song comes to my mind. Yep. Kumbaya. You know, to kind of fit along with the theme, you know. Well, I don't know, the show, what we do out at Vegas, we finish up with Ace in the Hole, or what was that one you talked about there?
Highway 40? Highway 40 Blues?
Highway 40 Blues. Oh, Ricky. Yeah. Ricky Skaggs. Man, ain't nobody can play guitar any faster than that boy.
He's a finger.
Man, he can get it.
You want to do that song?
I don't care.
You tell me what song we're singing.
What would Virginia like to hear?
Oh, she loves Ace in the Hole.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. We better go Ace in the Hole.
He's a George Strait kind of cat. You know, he comes on the TV and she perks up. And I run through the wall because she's not.
Yeah. You better get to singing, though. You've been talking about the singing you've been doing.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, that's. You know.
There it is.
Oh, gee.
Just wants you to get up and start
you guys,
your
you're
foot.
My backup boys, right?
You've got to have an ace in the hole, a little secret that nobody knows. Life is a gamble, a game we all play, but you have to save something for a rainy day. You've got to learn to play your cards right.
You got any threes?
You expect to win in life.
Get me off, go fish.
Don't put it all on the line for just one roll. You've got to have an ace in the hole.
Well, we appreciate y'all checking in, sticking around,
and listening to another episode of the Everything Rodeo Podcast. Be sure to like and subscribe.
Yeah.
Got any last jokes or anything?
Start the bus, Mom. We're out of here.
All right. We'll see you on the next one.
Thank you, guys.
Good night, Irene.
When life deals out a surprise.